boat ramp ran into the river where it flooded. Huge masses of, I mean, I don't know what they were doing, but it looked just like that. Afraid of going into the water, so they're gonna eat them. Have you ever seen, you know, bowfin, you know, bowfin?
Mm-hmm.
You ever seen bowfin with your babies?
That's so strange.
Mom and dad kind of make this circle around it, and they just kind of hurt it. Like eerie, whoa.
You have 1 minute.
And you watch, it's like, oh, crap, what are they doing?
Pencil's down, time is up. I watch too many of those cooking channels.
Yes.
Yeah.
I know, it's, time is up. Did you find it easier, harder to write with a quote? Was it?
I think it's easier.
Easier, because it gives you some kind of, you know, sort of a stepping stone, a place to go. Would anybody like to share their passenger pigeon observation? Sue, in the back.
Do you want me to read what quote I picked first, or?
Or you can tell us which quote, or I guess your quote will be incorporated into your writing, so however you...
I refer to it, so
okay.
I'll just read the quote. I did the one that said, when an individual is seen gliding through the woods and close to the observer, it passes like a thought, and on trying to see it again, the eye searches in vain, the bird is gone, by Audubon. And I wrote, Audubon, in his time, experienced much of the abundance of the bird population of the United States, here the passenger pigeon, and also in the Everglades, where he not only viewed the millions of wading birds, water birds, but went on short on shooting excursions there popular at the time. Had he only known the accuracy of his words, the prediction in their tone, that the bird population is fragile and passing and so easily gone. One wonders if he could have seen the future if he'd have hunted with the rest.
Anybody else?
I did it as late as the year 1882. Wild pigeons were very abundant in Illinois and Wisconsin. And about that time, their numbers began to decrease very rapidly. Besides the thousands which were shot, immense numbers were caught in nets of their breeding grounds, with the result that in 1895 it had become a rare bird. Looking at my first passenger pigeon not drawn in a book, I am overcome by its beauty. The city pigeons of today would never guess they were ever related to such a princely bird.
I like that city pigeon.
I took the quote, they sit up as if they had a wire drawn through them. The long-dead passenger pigeon preserved by taxidermy to give us a glimpse to the past. Wonderfully subtle colors and lifelike pose show off the fine qualities of the long-lost bird. Perched on that branch as if it had a wire drawn through it.
I think
you don't. I think that's a nail. I saw that.
How about somebody from this side of the room? Okay.
The one about the meteor.
Okay.
I can only imagine the sky filled with thousands of those muscular and acrobatic doves, a blue meteor shower that will never again be seen.
Well, this ends the writing portion, and I have a couple quotes. I hope that after we've gone through some different exercises, that you two now are like E.B. White when he says, even now, this late in the day, a blank sheet of paper holds the greatest excitement there is for me, more promising than a silver cloud and prettier than a red wagon. And of course, what Gore Vidal says, as every author and every reader knows, writing well is the best trip of them all. So I wish you many great journeys.
Thank you. Okay. I have a couple of things. I'll let you have a break. One of the things that we've been talking about, emphasizing, trying to get you to do, and the whole emphasis of this class is to keep and create a journal. Okay? Now, it can be, did you miss that? It can be a fleeting, I'm going to keep a journal, but it never really quite happens. So, you're going to create a journal, you know, the best intentions sometimes go up in flames, you know. The only way to do a journal is to start one, okay? And the only way to start one is to perceive that you have the skills to create a journal, right? And you do have the skills to create a journal. So, the other thing we found out is you're more likely to succeed at keeping a journal if you follow these few simple, don't call them rules.
Steps.
You have a definite goal in mind. In other words, it's a finite, you create a finite product. You keep the project finite. You set aside a routine time. For me, it's in the evening after dinner in the basement. You know, far away from the TV and all that kind of stuff. It's cold, it's damp, it's sticky. Nothing else to do down there. I turn on my music and I'm going to do it. You designate a workplace, that's my damp, dank basement, which you avoid outside distractions. You know, nothing going on except the occasional cockroach will scurry by, but that's about it. So if you do this, pretty soon doing this becomes you wear a path. I mean, you literally wear a path. Oh, I have to go work on my journal now. Okay, you create a trail from here all the way up to where you want to go. And it works. And it works, and it works. Sue every morning, every afternoon, or every evening, she's studying the birds of Peru. So she works on her bird journal every evening. All right. So, to show you an example of a couple of projects that I've got back here that I showed you. This is a journal which I did. It's a photo journal on the cache. And it's called The Colors of the Cache. And it was inspired by Sue's paint chip poetry. So, you know, you start out with, you find a nice symbolic image that will work. A nice opening statement, you know, that the cache is the color of a cafe au lait brown, muddy river surrounded by an intense green, and then you go through the seasons. And then you have a series of photos, which you then, you know, you don't have to describe. American feather foil, bright green asterisks running across the pages of the swamp. That's what was in my journal. And that's all I wrote about. And that's what ended up in this photo journal. Another one, sea oats. Sea oats green is the color of early summer. And it's really, in this nearly windless, humid season, it seems only fitting that the lima bean-hued wind chimes and the aeolian seismograph, silently claiming better, seem bent only on registering the faintest breath of wind. You ever tried to photograph sea oats? They never are still, okay? Another one here, this one is from Sue's. It says, in a chartreuse tuxedo trimmed in pencil razor pink, watermelon red, and eggplant purple with a bow tie of smooth, creamy yellow, who would resist the amorous intentions of this early spring luna? It's moth prom night in the swamp. From me, a curmudgeon in the mollies, you know. So, it goes on, and I mean, that's the way you, and here's one, a couple of pages to show you a different kind of journal. This one is based on sketching.
This is one night I went to photograph at night, and I forgot. I brought my tripod, I brought my camera, but I didn't bring the little connector between the two, so I was royally pissed off. But I did the hike anyway, and I ended up drawing instead of writing, and ended up writing instead of photographing. So I said, here I am again at Heron Pond. Perhaps I come here because it's timeless and familiar. Maybe it's like coming home. A full moon over the horizon provides hope for unusual photo opportunities, none of which I did. Can't tell. And along the way, it says, dusk must be the beaver's special time because I am accompanied by rifle shot claps from the Brown River. Leathery tails hit the water in repeated indignation. Perhaps they are irritated because they have no chance to dam this brown torrent, but more likely because I am keeping them from an evening meal of tender bark. And see, not the beaver, just an impression of the beaver's doing. And then this one has, along the way, I start like pterodactyl with a primeval and unmusical squawk. The great blue heron takes off in the opposite direction. At least that's what I believe it is. As the only thing that keeps me from fleeing its dinosaur-like commotion is that its sound is receding. A little bit scared the crap out of it. It's dark. And then finally, here's a page where I didn't write anything, just some of the things that you saw along the way. So that's the process of creating a journal. Get a finite thing, and then just, you don't have to do it all at once. Just start doing it.
How did you merge your graphics with your nice text?
Because I have horrible handwriting, and I have like you saw a handwritten ones are back here, and then I put the whole thing in the computer to make it look nice. Because if I was going to print it or publish it, that's what they would do anyway. They would use my stupid handwriting.
Nice. So. I'm just wondering how the mechanics.
Well, that's just Photoshop. It's
really high version of Photoshop.
No, you can do that in Photoshop Elements. You can do that. Photoshop is actually a really good program for doing this in. Sometimes we might have a. We didn't do that because most people don't have it, you know. We thought, well, everybody's going to be saying, I don't have that. Something in it. So.
Okay.
Break time, but before we take a break, before we do photography, I put something up on the board back here, and it's a series of posters, and it was an experiment that Sue and I did 2008, day after Thanksgiving, 2007, I don't know. We took our nieces, teenage nieces, 13 and 15, they came down for Thanksgiving. They said, well, you want to spend the night? And on the next day, we'll take you to Indiana to see the cranes. And they'd go, you know, teenagers. And they said, okay, we'll go. So we took a 13 and 15-year-old girl to see the sandhill cranes at Jasper Pulaski Wildlife Refuge. And just on a lark, we got there. I gave each one of them my camera. One of them had a 400 millimeter lens, one had a 300 millimeter lens. They never touched a 35 millimeter camera other than a point and shoot. And I told them how to push the shutter and how to push it halfway down to focus, and that's all I told them. We got there at 4 o'clock, and at 7 o'clock we had to pry them away because they were, and I made a poster of what they did. So the whole point of this is photography has gotten really much easier than it used to be. Because look what they did. And you tell me if it's, you know, that anybody can do this. Yes, you can. To do it consistently, you have to. And that's what we're going to talk about a little bit later. But I put that up so I can show you that, yes, just like Karen Wallace, you know, can't draw. Oh, Uncle Mike, we don't know how to do this. And I showed him that, and they're like, oh, yeah, we can. All right? So. Come back at 2:30. Break time. And put out the stuff that you did at lunch and share with people, and also.